Thank you, Chairperson, and thanks to the people who are still waiting to listen to my lecture. I'm going to talk about diabetes and resistant hypertension. That's what the topic initially given to me was, and over the period of time it has changed to diabetic nephropathy, but my focus right now will be on resistant hypertension. Now, treatment-resistant hypertension is defined as a failure to achieve goal blood pressure in patients who are adhering to full doses of an appropriate three-drug regimen that includes a diuretic. Now, this is a very rather complex definition, but to understand it, it's important that all of you should realize that there are three components to it. One is treatment adherence, which is normally not there. Number two is there have to be three drugs in full doses or appropriate doses. And number three is there has to be a diuretic as a component of these three drugs. The second, there is one more definition, and that is if a person is not controlled by four medications, again adherent and on full dose, that also, and that may be without a diuretic, that also is taken as a definition of resistant hypertension. Now, this is not synonymous with the uncontrolled hypertension or difficult to treat hypertension, because in that case, the drug therapy may not be appropriate. Now, what's the prevalence of this particular disease? What you see here is that if you use these two definitions, at least in the USA, the prevalence is going up. This is the NANS data from 1988 to 2008, and initially it was 6.5% reported, now it is 13.4. So clearly an increase in the treatment-resistant hypertension using both these definitions. In India, we don't really have data on the resistant hypertension. What we did was we did a registry of hypertensive patients, about 2,000 patients who were on multiple drugs, and according to the definition of resistant hypertension, what we find was that if there were three drugs, one of them was diuretic, the prevalence was about 10%. And if you use the second definition, that is four or more drugs, the prevalence is about 5%. Clearly, the resistant hypertension is as common in India as in the US. Now, what are the implications of resistant hypertension? It is not only important to identify patients who are at risk, because these patients are at risk for blood pressure-related complications, and that's why the treatment-resistant hypertension is important. They can have greater incidence of cardiovascular disease. They also have greater incidence of renal disease, and there are different management strategies for this particular type of blood pressure. But before diagnosing a person as a resistant hypertension or therapy-resistant hypertension, it's very important to exclude certain conditions, which is known as pseudo-resistance. Now, this may include a white coat hypertension, which can be excluded by ambulatory blood pressure monitoring. There could be a measurement error at the level of physician, and there could be non-adherence to therapies, which also needs to be checked. There is a long list of medications which can also lead to resistant hypertension. All of you can go through over these medicines, a number of them. Important ones are NSAIDs, or non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, corticosteroids, and antidepressants, although the last ones mentioned here, the nicotine, energy drinks, excessive alcohol intake are also component of this particular therapy. Now, what are the patient characteristics? At least in the US, they have identified characteristics like old age, blacks, females, higher baseline blood pressure, obesity, chronic kidney disease, insulin resistance, and left ventricle hypertrophy, which are the common accompaniments. Again, showing the risk factors for resistant hypertension. And what you'll see here is non-adherence is very important. Medication causes more than half of the spectrum of resistant hypertension. There are special characteristics of hypertension and diabetes, and they are normally in patients with hypertension and diabetes, there is lack of nocturnal dipping, there is a high nocturnal blood pressure. On ambulatory blood pressure, you can find this out. There's a greater early morning blood pressure surge. There's greater salt sensitivity. That's why the diuretics are useful. They have higher systolic blood pressure and higher incidence of isolated systolic hypertension. they have greater resistant hypertension, and the goals of therapy are different, although the latest one says that 140 over 90 in both diabetics and non-diabetics are to be followed. In our study, hypertension is very highly prevalent in diabetes, and what you see here is hypertension in about 73% of patients of diabetes in India, clearly showing that these two diseases go side by side. And in patients with resistant hypertension, again, there were 190 patients, out of which 68% had diabetes. So I think diabetes is a reason for resistant hypertension, and hypertension and diabetes coexist in a great majority of patients. How do you manage that? Three or four important components of the therapy of resistant hypertension. One is we need to confirm treatment resistance by various clinical parameters. We need to focus on aggressive lifestyle changes. We need to rule out secondary causes, and we need to treat secondary causes. And of course, then there is a pharmacological therapy. Now, confirmation of resistant hypertension is basically using office and home blood pressure measurement technique. We need to evaluate for the white coat hypertension, and we need to evaluate interfering substances, the long list of drugs which I gave. We need to exclude pain and anxiety. In terms of confirmation of treatment, we need to assess and educate about the adherence of the patient, cost, frequency of dosing, side effects. We need to promote self-adjusting dosing regime, and we need to identify and to treat the contributing lifestyle factors. Adherence is the single most important method by which we can improve the patient management of resistant hypertension. For that, there are a number of strategies available. We can simplify the medication regime. We can have appropriate drug selection dependent on patient characteristics. There has to be an improved patient-physician communication, appropriate education, behavioral strategies, social support, continuous monitoring. An important concept in hypertension management is task sharing or task shifting. For many years, for centuries, as doctors, we believe that we are the only ones who are empowered to treat patients. But that's not true in the 21st century. We need to take help for a problem such as hypertension, which is widely prevalent. We need to have practicing nurses, pharmacists, and the nurse practitioners who can help us in managing a patient of hypertension better as compared to us. And this is a concept which has come from diabetes management, because diabetes educators have done such a wonderful job in treating and controlling diabetes. And the same concept has to come in hypertension management. Patient empowerment is the 21st century medicine. And I think it's not new. Galileo, about 600 years ago, talked about patient empowerment. You can't teach a man anything. You can only help him discover within himself. This has been known for Galileo. This has been known for ages by our ancient sages. But the current way of self-management of hypertension is the patient empowerment, and this may use the cell phone or the mobile technology or the mHealth technology by which a patient can manage his blood pressure, can measure his blood pressure using a cell phone. I mean, there are devices available now, apps available, which measure blood pressure, which can warn you for high blood pressure, which can warn you, which can make alarm for the of the drug intake. So I think there's lots of things going on as far as the ML technology is concerned for improving adherence. The second issue is the lifestyle factors, and we all know that lifestyle factors are very important, and if you control lifestyle factors well, you can improve the quality of life in resistant hypertension. Weight reduction, healthy eating plan, sodium reduction, promotion of physical activity, and decrease in the alcohol consumption. All are very useful lifestyle techniques. We need to evaluate for secondary hypertension, and my previous speaker just now talked about obstructive sleep apnea. I have listed obstructive sleep apnea as the most important reversible cause of resistant hypertension. It's very, very common, it's very prevalent, and I think we tend to underdiagnose it. We need to be aware that obstructive sleep apnea is a risk factor for hypertension, as a risk factor for treatment-resistant hypertension. And then there's a huge list of chronic kidney disease, thyroid disease, parathyroid disease, Renovascular disease, medication, Cushing's, aldosterone, pheochromocytoma, illicit substances, and coarctation. All these are important causes. All these are treatable causes for secondary resistant hypertension. Now, what is the prevalence of this? There's a study published in the John Wall's book on hypertension, and it says white coat hypertension is the commonest in primary care. In tertiary care, not as common. In suburb, the second most important cause is the suboptimal medication, and very common in the tertiary care practices. Almost half of the patients have a suboptimal medication. Sleep apnea, again, depending on where you are practicing, 1 to 83% patients with resistant hypertension have sleep apnea. In a separate study, in a review published in the Journal of American Medical Association last year, about 3-4 months ago, again, obstructive sleep apnea is number one cause of resistant hypertension. The number two cause is primary aldosteronism. The number three cause is renal artery stenosis, renal parenchymal disease, and drug-induced causes. CPAP has clearly shown benefit. This is a randomized trial of a patient of resistant hypertension using CPAP versus control, 98 patients here, 96 patients there, clearly showing that you can induce a significant decline in both systolic and diastolic blood pressure, also in the 24-hour mean blood pressure, if you use this technique well. The third step in management of resistant hypertension is optimization of the medicine combinations. We all know that resistant hypertension is a very complex sort of a mixture: renal sodium, decreased filtration, sympathetic overactivity, RAS excess, cell membrane alterations, and hyperinsulinemia all contribute to the spectrum of resistant hypertension. The important thing to remember is that resistant hypertension, or high or normal hypertension also, normal, but if you want to control it, you require two or more drugs. So clearly, there's a need for combination pharmacotherapy, and this diagram from the latest ESH guidelines is important because it tells you what are good combinations shown in green and what are bad combinations shown in red. So clearly, ACE inhibitor ARB is a bad combination. ACE inhibitor calcium channel blockers, ACE inhibitor diuretics are a good combination. So we should promote good combinations and not bad combinations. Other issue is we need to optimize medicine combinations. We need to ensure that diuretics is of appropriate class, thiazides or non-thiazides. Normally, loop diuretics don't work for resistant hypertension unless the GFR is less than 30, when the thiazides fail to work. We can add a vasodilatory beta blocker, and we could optimize the timing of medication. The important drug in management of resistant hypertension is spironolactone, and this is more true for diabetic resistant hypertensives because this is very, very effective. Diabetes has a spironolactone axis and all these mineralocorticoid receptor antagonists. This is an example of spironolactone showing clearly benefit in both systolic and diastolic blood pressures. A new concept coming up in diabetic hypertension is you use first-line three-drug combination at the start of therapy for hypertension in diabetics, because normally it has been seen that single drugs or double drugs don't work. And the first-line three drugs are diuretics, calcium channel blockers, both DHP group and the non-DHP, and the ACE inhibitors or ARBs. As a fourth-line drug, you could add a mineralocorticoid receptor blocker, either spironolactone or eplerenone. And then as a fifth-line drug, you could have gyrate-renin inhibitors or beta blockers or alpha blockers or central sympatholytics. And of course, the rare drug are tartrazine or minoxidil, which are no longer used, at least in this country. RAS blockage is very important in diabetic nephropathy because and the use is either ACE inhibitors or ARB is the cornerstone of therapy in diabetic nephropathy. Single agent RAS blockade does not lead to complete RAS activation, and the residual risk is high. And then, so we have either a dietary sodium restriction, we can increase the drug dosage, or we can use novel drugs to block RAS activation. This includes spironolactone or direct renin inhibitors. And finally, there is a role for interventional therapies. Now, interventional therapies is of two types, being tested in resistant hypertension. One is renal denervation therapies, which basically involves the ablation of renal nerves along the renal arteries in the adventitial layers. Initial trials, Simplicity 1, Simplicity 2, showed promise as far as therapy of resistant hypertension is concerned. There was a huge decline in the both systolic and diastolic blood pressure over a period of 1 year in these two studies, which were not randomized. But in a randomized trial, which was Simplicity 3, it failed. I'll just show you the data. And the second strategy is the carotid sinus stimulation. Again, a difficult technique. You place a stimulator in the supraclavicular region. It stimulates the, there is a chronic electrical stimulation leading to baroreflex mediated inhibition of sympathetic activity of the carotid sinus, and that produces lowering of blood pressure. Difficult technique, not universally available. Now, these are the data from the Simplicity 3, which is renal denervation trial. It failed to show any benefit. So this is the baseline, and this is at 6 months in the denervation arm and in the sham control arm, where they just put in the catheter and remove the catheter, didn't do any denervation, and a large number of patients. So clearly here also there was a decline from baseline by 14 millimeters. And in the control group, again, 11.7 millimeters, not significant difference. In both the groups, there was a significant decline, but intergroup comparison were not important. And this is the ambulatory blood pressure recording data, again showing no significant benefit. In this study also, in the subgroup of patients with diabetes, there was no significant difference in blood pressure change in the denervation group versus the sham procedure group. So right now the debate on the renal denervation therapy is going on. There could be some more studies on use of renal denervation, especially in a subset of patients with very high degree of renal of resistant hypertension, and that may lead to some other studies. But I think right now the court is still open. Whether denervation therapy works or not, there is a big question. And finally, you could have an advanced hypertension program, and I think I will recommend all of you, all of people who deal with diabetes, who deal with hypertension, who deal with resistant hypertension, to have a multidisciplinary team, which is ideal for patients with difficult to treat or accelerated hypertension, hypertension at young age, suspected secondary white coat or masked hypertension with multiple cardiovascular risk factors, and there's an early or progressive kidney disease. Now, these services include a team-based visits. There are multiple people seeing the same patient, nutritional counseling, exercise prescription, imaging, 24-hour monitoring, and interventions. So this is the way forward, and I think we need to do that to achieve optimal blood pressure control in patients with resistant hypertension. So ladies and gentlemen, I conclude that resistant hypertension is a common problem in clinical practice, especially secondary care and tertiary care. Patients with diabetes have a greater prevalence of resistant hypertension. We must exclude secondary causes. Almost 50 to 70% of patients with resistant hypertension have secondary cause, and we need to exclude that. And the commonest cause which is present is non-adherence, interfering medication, and obstructive sleep apnea. So these are important. We need to focus on aggressive lifestyle changes. We need to promote adherence. We have to have a stepwise algorithm for drug therapy, diuretics, calcium channel blockers, ACE inhibitors, all ARBs. We need to add mineralocorticoid receptor antagonists, and diuretics are important choices. And finally, with the current evidence, there is a limited role of renal denervation therapy. Thank you.